So this is a family, non-consanguineous couple, two babies. They both have developmental abnormality. So one is at 15 years of age, other one is at 8 years of age. One second, please hold on. One is at 15 years, other one is at 8 years of age. And again, they've not been evaluated. Next slide. You can see 8 years old, 15 years old, developmental delay, not evaluated. Next slide. So they've come with an ongoing pregnancy of 14 weeks where we don't have the diagnosis of previous babies. Here, the hurdle is time and also the money. The family has to spend a lot to find out the diagnosis now. Do it immediately because it is already 14 weeks to test the fetus. Already it is high time. We don't have the diagnosis of the previous babies. So we have a whole lot of investigation for these family because it is just a developmental delay, neurodevelopmental delay. Next slide. These children have significant dysmorphism, recurrence is there. So definitely it is a genetic disorder. So, but again, we don't know the recurrence risk of this particular fetus because we don't know the genetic diagnosis. Next slide. The whole list is there, karyotyping, your next generation sequencing, anything it can be. But the family, fortunately or unfortunately, were affordable only for karyotyping. And then we did for the second child, we found a derivative chromosome 9. This is a chromosomal abnormality. Next slide. And we checked the father. He was carrying the balanced translocation, and we tested the fetus, and fetus was found to be normal. You imagine what is the pressure situation in this family. Already they've got two children who have neurodevelopmental delay, where they are struggling with these children. They've come with an ongoing pregnancy. We know there is a recurrence. We don't know what is the genetic diagnosis. Luckily, we've got the answer here. But again, this is just a success story. There are so many failure stories we have come across when the family present to us with an ongoing pregnancy. Next slide. Next one, yeah. So third degree consanguineous couple and floppiness. Baby was alert till the end, weakness and poor feeding, baby died. They now reported at 9 weeks of gestation. Next slide. Luckily, this family had a genetic evaluation done in the previous child. This is a big relief for us. We have a diagnosis here, spinal muscular atrophy. So SMN1, exon 7 and 8 deletion is there. We are relieved. We are in a good, better position to test this fetus than the previous family because we have the index patient and the index patient genetic report previous babies. Next slide. So we did parental screening and then they were found to be positive. Next slide. The babies were, fetus was tested. Next slide. Fetus was tested. Fetus was negative for spinal muscular atrophy. This is a big relief because it becomes very easy when we have a genetic diagnosis of the previous baby. Next slide. Next. Yeah. So 32 years old male, he is born to third degree consanguineous parents. He is born to third degree consanguineous parents. He has retinitis pigmentosa. He is married non-consanguineously. His parents are relatives, but his wife is not relative. He has got retinitis pigmentosa, Stargardt's disease, eye vision problem. Okay. So next slide. We did genetic diagnosis, genetic evaluation in him. We found out a mutation in ABCA4 gene. And homozygous status, this confirms the genetic diagnosis in him. And we tested the mother and father. We found their carriers. So here, if you look into this, ABCA4 exon 33 is the location of this abnormality. So parents were carriers of the same because they are consanguineous couple. But the family's worry is whether this person's wife, if she conceives, the baby will get retinitis pigmentosa or not. We don't know. We know the genetic status of this particular patient, but we did not know the genetic basis of his wife who is more married non-consanguineously. Non-consanguineous means she's from a new family. So her genetic mutation may not reflect all that of the affected person. Next slide. Next slide. Next one. So next slide. Yeah, rightly so. The mother was checked for that particular mutation in the exon 33, but it was absent. So we have to remember that she is married non-consanguineously. The mutation can be anywhere in a common group. So we did complete gene sequencing of ABCA4 gene. Surprisingly, we've got a mutation which is pathogenic in exon 42. She is a silent carrier, heterozygous. This means she is from another family, but she is a silent carrier of a other exon variation in the same gene. This means there is a recurrence risk in the next pregnancy. Prenatal diagnosis can be done. This is the hurdle we face when we evaluate a family who with a non-consanguineous parentage for recurrence risk. Next slide. Next one. Okay, so the family, non-consanguineous couple, not related. So the first baby, ectopic pregnancy terminated. The second one, at 31 weeks, all the scans were normal. At 31 weeks, we found out that the baby has echogenic debris in the amniotic fluid, eclabion, ectropion, suspected lamellar ichthyosis. The pregnancy, they went ahead, presented in the board and got terminated. And postnatal pictures, next slide. Is like this. This is Harlequin ichthyosis, severe form of ichthyosis which involves the skin. Died soon after delivery. I'm looking at this picture, I know this is a single gene disorder involving the dermatology skin alone, and we have to do the genetic evaluation. What do we need now? To do a genetic evaluation for this, what should we do now? What do we need now? Next slide. We need the DNA of the baby. So we stored the DNA of the baby previously before termination, and from that DNA, we started testing and we found out a mutation in ABCA 12G12 gene, and then again it is heterozygous format in an autosomal recessive condition. We always want homozygous status in an affected individual, but it is a pathogenic mutation. So I know it is single gene disorder. This gene is very well fitting with the phenotype of the baby, but only thing is it is heterozygous. I don't have an answer in the other allele. In the pair, one allele mutation has been found out. Other allele, we have not found out anything. But I've got the clue. This is the gene. So next level, next slide. Next level, we did exon array of the gene. We found out, next slide. We found out, yeah, next slide. We found out a deletion in the gene. So one mutation is a point mutation. Other allele, the baby had a variant, which is a deletion, which was found out by another level of testing. So regular gene sequencing is not found out. So we went ahead, did the deletion of that particular gene, and then we found out this mutation by exon array. So this is how we always evaluate and find out, decipher the genetic mutations. Next slide. So father, mother, carrier status showed one mutation in the mother. Next slide. Next one. Next one, yeah, father was carrier of the deletion. So mother was carrier of the point mutation, father was carrier of the deletion, two different variants in a family with a non-consanguineous couple, which is unexpected. This is called compound heterozygous status. This is enough for us to evaluate in the next pregnancies. Next slide. Next one. So this is a family. Second degree consanguineous couple, first child, normal pregnancy, normal till 6 months postnatally. Baby had febrile illness for 2 days, acidosis, lethargy, seizures. Baby died very soon. 2 days, baby died. So they didn't have enough time to evaluate completely, but luckily, next slide. The pediatrician has done a urine organic acid profile. We've got a result called chorea beta-ketotalase deficiency. This is a genetic disorder. The clinical picture typically fits in with that. In spite of the information, previous slide, in spite of the information to get genetic evaluation before conception, they came with an ongoing pregnancy of 24 weeks. They didn't evaluate further. Previous baby died, no genetic mutation, no DNA store. They came with an ongoing pregnancy of 24 weeks. Now again, time matters. Starting an evaluation in a family at 24 weeks without genetic evaluation, doing fetus is next to impossible. So we were unable to do fetal testing. 24 weeks, we don't have any answer here. If we start evaluating the family, it will take at least 8 to 10 weeks. 34 weeks, we cannot test the fetus. Next slide. So parallelly, what we started evaluating the family members. We evaluated the couple, the father and mother. We found out the mutation. But unfortunately, we were unable to proceed to the prenatal diagnosis in the fetus because of the time constraints. Next slide. So baby was allowed to be born. And then baby, after being born, we tested and the baby was found to be positive. This is a failure story. This would have been definitely avoided if they would have come to us in the right time after the first baby is died. If they have come to us, then we can plan the treatment options, at least preventive options. Now we will move on to the last slide. You can just skip on all the slides and we will move on to the last three slides. These are say similar histories of how we evaluated, how we crossed the struggles. All these will be seen in these case scenarios. We don't have time now. We will discuss all these later. But again, the concept is the same. Next slide. Next. Yeah. We'll move on to the final conclusion. Yeah. So with all these efforts, all these challenges, you are crossing, next slide. You are crossing all these hurdles and then you are giving an answer.